Hi, my name is Laura Grossenbacher. I'm the director of the Technical Communication Program, and I'm here to talk about using active and passive voice. Wendy Crone asked me to come and talk a little bit about this. It's come up in classes, and I think it comes up often in engineering classes, because engineering students are typically asked to write in passive voice for their lab reports. And at the same time, in EPD 397, we are trying to encourage, that's the technical communication course for those that may not know that class, we are trying to teach the students that they should use as much active voice as they can because it tends to be a style that's more direct and efficient. So I thought I would do this little taping and go through a couple of different examples to show what this is, why it matters to people, and raise some questions about it. So one of the things I've noticed in trying to talk about this over the years is that people don't really know what passive voice is and the difference between passive voice and past tense, and they get it muddled up some with the use of I and we. And so some of what I'm going to talk about is going to address those areas of confusion. I have a PowerPoint presentation that I'll go through, and if you want to, you should have a link to this, and if you want to click on the link for using active and passive voice, look at the second slide there after the opening there, where I say passive voice is not the same thing as past tense, but it does employ past tense. This is something that sometimes people get confused. They think passive voice means past tense. And in the simple diagram that I have on this slide, you'll see that I have some passive voice, a simple sentence like the X widget has been developed. That's passive voice. And I've got what looks like sort of a Venn diagram where I've got developed in a circle to show you that developed is past tense. The whole structure is in passive voice. The X widget has been developed. So people recognize passive voice as something that has usually a to-be verb or hooked to an ED verb. And so past tense is part of the structure. But you should know that passive voice can also be in present tense. You could say something like, the X widget is being developed today. And that's passive voice too. It doesn't have a past tense verb in it. So don't equate these two things as being exactly the same thing because they're not. Passive voice really refers to who the agent is that's is doing the action and who's receiving the action. When you have passive structures, usually what you have is the direct object of a sentence that seems to be passively the agent in the sentence. And so if you look at page 3 here, where I have what is the difference between active and passive voice, you can see some simple examples here. Active voice emphasizes the person or the agent doing the action. Sometimes it'll even be, if it's a machine that operates by itself, it's a machine operating by itself. Here the example is just Dr. Teal, that's the agent or the doer of the action, completed the field study yesterday. That's classic passive voice. It tells you who did it. It does have an ED verb, so it's got past tense in it, but it's not passive voice. It's active because it tells us who did that work. Passive voice emphasizes the person or thing which is acted upon, and the real subject of the action is either missing or delayed. So what you have then is a change in emphasis in passive voice. We don't care so much about who did the action. What we care about is what happened. And so you'll see sentences like this. The field study was completed yesterday. Doesn't mention anything about who did it. Dr. Teal is not part of the sentence. Now you could put in, you could say the field study was completed yesterday by Dr. Teal. But a lot of times in technical writing, we don't even mention who did the work because we want the emphasis to be on the work done, not the doer of the work. And so I think most students who have had to write lab reports, they understand that about passive voice. You take I or we or the person doing the action out of the sentence and you emphasize the work done. Why would some readers then prefer active voice? You've been doing so many lab reports in passive. Why would you ever want to think about active? Well, I want you to consider a couple of things. Because active voice emphasizes the people doing the action, it can be more humanizing, showing us who's responsible for the work. Sometimes that enlivens writing if we can think about not just what was done, but exactly who did that work. It can make it even easier to follow. And I'll tell you where this specifically becomes a problem in especially things like if you're writing a research proposal. In a research proposal, often you have to establish who did existing work that's out there. Who's done, if you're talking about background and you're talking about different researchers, you have to talk about all the stuff that has been done already. It makes sense there to mention the names of those researchers when you can. And then as you shift into what your goals might be for your own research, you're trying to establish all of this has been done, now we want to do this new work and we're aiming in this direction, here are our goals, I think it makes sense there to use some active voice because it emphasizes the difference between the work you want to do and the work that's already been done. And if you're not careful in a research proposal like that, we can get confused if it's all in passive voice and we're not really ever clear about who's doing what work and what has been done by whom. We can start thinking, okay, so has this work already been done by these researchers, or is this work that's planned to be, that's really on the table and really in the, you know, people are planning to do it, but they haven't quite done all of this yet, and who's going to do this work? And so active voice is helpful in just sorting out who is doing what and when, okay? So human agents do engage readers more. We like to see when we can. I know they've done brain studies on this even, and it's kind of interesting. They've used that functional MRI, and they've shown that parts of the brain light up more when you use active voice. And so I think there's some good evidence that suggests that the writing is livelier when you use active voice. So those are some reasons why you might want to go to active voice. It often can create more efficient sentences as well. I could show you a lot of examples where if you run passive next to an active voice is just going to be, an active voice paragraph can be much shorter than a passive voice paragraph. So there's some good reasons to do that, but I guess what we should get down to is that audiences still demand passive voice. There are a lot of technical professionals who believe that passive voice is exactly what you want to have in a technical journal and that you should write that way whenever you have a formal technical document. And so I started thinking about this I started thinking that part of the reason why folks want the passive structure in the technical documents is that it sounds more objective. Whenever you put in human agents, whenever you put in, if you dare to use I or we, you may end up with people feeling like there's more subjectivity in a document. And science is supposed to be objective. And I think this is part of the reason why for generations we've had more passive structures in the technical documents that are out there. And that's one thing that I'd like to challenge. I'd like to challenge the notion that all formal technical documents cannot use I or we. I would suggest that there are some places where it's useful and pragmatic to use I or we, and it's more direct. But I would also say you always have to check with your audience and find out what do they want. So if you've got a professor there who says to you, I want passive voice, you should ask them, well, does that mean that we can't ever use active voice, or does that mean that you just don't want us to use I or we? Okay? Because you should know that there is a difference here. You can use active structures that don't use I or we, but they're just an active voice. And so you can look at another example I'll make available to you. I did some research and I pulled out some documents written by different engineering professors. One of them is from Wendy Crone. Another is written by Larry Bank and Jeff Russell and a few other people from the civil engineering department. And you can look at what I've done here. I won't go through it with you, but as you look at this document, you'll see that I've highlighted the passive structures and the active structures with different colors in each paragraph, and it'll show you that a lot of our own researchers here shift back and forth between active and passive structures all the time within the same paragraph. There's no rule against doing that. In fact, that's a good thing to do because it creates variety in your style. And these writers in these documents never use I or we anywhere. They're just doing things like one goal of the current research is to assess the suitability of a multi-layer cold rolling effect. Effort for the preparation of NITI laminate composites, blah, blah, blah. And so it goes on like that, and then it shifts then into some passive voice. These thicknesses can be produced with this method. And so you see a nice back and forth between active and passive if you look at this handout. And so my point here is simply you can use active and passive structures without using I or we. And the question you should be asking your audiences then is it that you just don't want to use I or we? You know, because active structures can be very useful in a document without IRWE. I want to draw your attention to another document then that I'll make available to you. And this is something written by Eric Hellstrom, who was at UW for many years and recently moved to Florida to do research there. Eric, I knew personally, and I know that he felt very strongly that student writing particularly needs to be more direct. He insisted that his students use IRWE. And so the document you'll look at here was written for the Office of Naval Research, and it was a document, a final report written after some research had been conducted. And the interesting thing about this document is that you see IRWE throughout this. We found regimes for the heating rate, slow heating led to large non-superconducting second phases in the melt. He goes on, a lot of his sentences use we or I, and it's pretty clear to read, and what's nice about it is that it seems really actively engaged with the research, which would be something I think you'd want to communicate to a funding agency. I think they would appreciate to see, wow, you're working hard with these, with the money that we've given you. And so I find this report easy to read, very direct, and not as confusing as some passive structures that you can see in some documents. Certainly, some of my students have written documents that have confusing passages because you can't sort out who's doing the work. And here it's very clear. So I'd ask you just to look at that and then think about, finally, this whole question about, okay, for many years, technical journals have demanded that you don't use IRWE. There are people, there are professors all over the place who will say, IRWE, these are not words we want to use. It's too subjective. It puts too much emphasis on the researcher, and we don't want to do that. We want to put emphasis on the research done. And I would just simply say, when you are worrying about this thing, first ask your audiences, what do they want? And then ask them why. Why do they want it? Is there a real reason why you should never use IRWE? Can you use IRWE when you talk about goals of research and conclusions that you're drawing? Because those seem to be places, for my students in my technical communication courses, those are the places where I'll say to people, I don't mind seeing I, or if you're on a team, we, in those critical areas where you're talking about, this is what I want to do, and this is what I conclude, and this is what I recommend. I don't like to see an overuse of IRWE, but I do like to see the occasional interjection of that active voice and the first person so that I know the difference between what you're working on and the work that you've described other people have done. So I know that this is liable to create some discussion. I would love to hear feedback on these ideas because I know that not all professors are on the same page about it. I know the people in the technical communication program have talked a lot about this issue, and we all tend to believe we want to emphasize and encourage active voice when we can, but we can't buck the whole system, and we know there are a lot of people who will say, absolutely try to cast everything in passive voice. So I think it's something that should be discussed. I'd love to get feedback or hear about the discussions that you have in class after seeing this video. Thank you.